Good morning, everyone. How are you today? Good. Hey, let's all stand up. And it's so good to be together this morning. We're going to worship. And welcome. Just be the first to say welcome today. As we begin our worship, let's just remember the new identity that we've been given in Christ, that we are children of the light. And let's read from 1 Peter 2:9 this morning. Let's all read aloud together. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. For once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So today we're going to come to Jesus, who is our light. We're going to look to him with joy. We're going to open up our hearts and sing to him. We've been singing this song called Running to the Light. So let's sing this together today. All right, guys, here we go.
You can have my yes with no exception. I'm laying down my rights to second guessing. You can have my yes. I'm giving you my fear of never knowing. Whatever's coming next, I know you got me. You can have my yes.
You you know just what to do.
We're going to open up a space to pray right now. So if you just kind of quiet your heart and your mind before the Lord. And I love that chorus that we just sang. It's a great way to come into the house of God today. Hallelujah, our God reigns. We look to Jesus and we know that he is good. And so today as a church, we're just going to come together and we're going to pray the words thank you together. And thank you, those are powerful words. They're words that are able to reframe your perspective that you walked in here with this morning. The words thank you are a gateway to praise, and they open up your heart to receive from the Lord. The words thank you, they help you to see yourself rightly. You know, you and I, we're not people who are owed anything by God. But oh, the grace, the extravagant love that God has poured out towards us. And so when we posture ourselves and we posture not just our hearts, but our whole being, our minds, our mouths, our hands, and we just posture ourselves in a way of saying thank you. We're going to do that right now, just like Colossians 3:16-17 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. So whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. So let's pray together right now, out loud. I want everyone to pray out loud at the same time. Is that going to be weird for anybody? I think it's amazing to let our praises rise out loud together. And just pray something like, Jesus, I know you are good and thank you for. And then just open up that faucet of thanksgiving. Open up that faucet of praise. Let that thanks flow. So let's lift our praise right now. I'm going to count us down. 3, 2, 1. Let's pray together right now. Lord Jesus, how good is he? Far beyond what eyes could ever see. Yet he stands in front of me. How good is he? He paints a canvas with a million scars. Yet still he holds my heart. sing Our Father.
And Our Father in heaven, the light of salvation.
Come on, sing.
Oh, how good is He, the breath of Almighty, before and behind me. Oh, how good is He,
and how good is He.
Forgiveness isn't bound by sin.
When death had claimed its victory, the King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history, there on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known.
Oh, hey. this is just the dress rehearsal. We get to do that for eternity. I'm so excited. But you guys can go ahead and have a seat. My name is Claudia. I'm one of the ministry coordinators here at the church, and we are just so thankful that you've gathered here to worship with us today. If this is your first time, some of our staff is going to be out in the lobby. We would love to get to meet you before you guys leave, and just know that you're part of a family, so we are so excited to get to meet you today. But whether this is your first or your millionth time here, we would love for you to check in. There's some QR codes that are behind the chairs, so feel free to use that, or you can use the Harvest app as well. But while you're there, just let us know how we can be praying for you. Our staff and our volunteers love to get to do that each and every single week, so let us know how we can be caring for you this week. But hey, if you're going into junior high, either 6th through 8th grade, we have a special service. It's actually happening right now, today. So you can actually stand right up, grab your Bible. Ashlyn's right over there. She has a very bougie sign that she made, and she's really loud that you can hear her from here. So we're so excited. You guys can go out there, and it's going to be a great service for you guys. One of the things that I'm super excited about is we have a Spanish ministry night that's happening next Saturday, June 18th at 5 p.m. It's happening here on our campus. Super exciting. It's going to be a preaching, worship, fellowship, all in Spanish. So if that would be a blessing for you, you can sign up just to what dish to bring. We're having a potluck right afterwards at harvestbible.org. Or you can stop and see me out in the lobby, and I would love to help answer any questions you may have. Vamos a tener una noche de ministerio en español que va a estar pasando la próxima semana. Va a ser junio 18 a las 5. Va a ser un gran tiempo. Va a haber comida, alabanza, predicación, todo en español. So nos encantaría si podrían venir aquí. Va a ser a las 5 y pueden ganar más información en harvestbible.org. And if you didn't know what I just said, we would love for you still to come, and I'll teach you Spanish. So it's going to be an amazing time. Well, church, it says in Matthew 7:7-8, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open. For everyone who asks receives. And the one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be opened. And we are having a great opportunity that's coming up. It's happening on Thursday, June 23rd at 7 p.m. here on our campus. It's a time for all of our church to gather to do just that. We're going to have an extended time of prayer and worship. And we're going to ask the Lord to move in a mighty way. So would you join us that day? It's going to be an amazing time. Well, one of my favorite parts that we get to do in our service is to pray for like-minded gospel churches. Aren't you thankful that God's not just moving here, but he's moving all throughout our county? So, hey, I'm excited to pray for High Point Church in Naperville and for Pastor Ron Zappia. So would you join me in prayer today? Lord, we're just so thankful for just the ways that you move. God, we're thankful that you're moving in our state, in our country, in our world, Father, and that you are being glorified. So we just pray for High Point today. Would you continue to move in their people? Would you give them wisdom and discernment to their leadership as to how to be able to guide their people closer to you? And we just pray, Lord, that that church would be a beacon of hope in their community, all for your glory. And we just pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, church, we get the privilege to be able to continue in worship and our giving. I love that we don't give out of compulsion, but we give out of a heart of gratitude. So there's a couple ways on the screen of how you can give, or there's some blue boxes in the back as well. But as we just prepare our hearts to give, would you guys stand as we continue in worship?
If it's bandaging the broken, washing filthy feet, here I am, Lord, send me. If it's loving one another, even when we don't agree, here I am, Lord, send me. If I'm poor, if I'm wealthy, I'll serve you just the same. Here I am, Lord, send me. On the mountain or the valley, and I will choose to praise. Here I am, Lord, send me. If I'm known by how I love, let my life reflect how much like an arrow, I will say it anyway. Here I am, Lord, send me. If it means that they'll reject me, Lord, I'll still obey. Here I am, Lord, send me. If I'm be glad I chose to say, here I am, Lord, send me. Well done, good and faithful, how I live to hear you say, here I am, Lord, send me. Yes, here I am.
Lord, we're before you now, and really, a song like that is more than just a song from us, Father, but I know that you have placed us, called us to be light, to be ambassadors, to be your messengers, and so, that song, Lord, is a song of surrender and willingness to do that. And even as we, you know, leave here today, all the spheres of influence that you've given, we create culture. Would you make us culture makers that are formed after your image? And it would be your hands and feet and words to people in our lives. We pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ, and all God's people together said, amen. Amen. Well, hey, we are starting a new series today on Elijah, and so go ahead and take a seat and turn your attention to the screens.
Hi there. Yeah, it's great to see you today. It's excellent to have all you guys join us by video. You need a Bible, and you need to open it to 1 Kings chapter 17. If you're kind of new to Christianity, well, it's the front end of the book. It's in the Old Testament. It's the front end of the book. Usually you can find a table of contents in the front of your Bible, and it'll tell you where 1 Kings is. We're in 1 Kings chapter 17. We're going to study verses 1 to 7. Today, and while you're trying to figure out how to get there, let me tell you about a weird experience that I had a few years ago. I was leading a team of high school kids on a mission trip to Guatemala, and when we were there, we ended up wanting to go on a day to a town called Chichicastenango, which I still love to say, Chichicastenango, and going up there was quite a journey. It's up in the mountains. The reason you go there for most people is because it is a really good taste of the historic Mayan culture. And the people from the mountains will come down into Chichicastenango and they'll sell all their wares. And if you've ever been to the two-thirds world, and you know what I'm talking about when I'm saying they sell their wares. It's like all these tents at a market and huge market and blankets and beads and belts and like anything you can think of is all there. I'm not really good at the haggling. Like some people love it. They go and they try to buy cheap things from people who need the money. So, right? Shouldn't we just pay their, anyway. So anyway, we go and we try to haggle. But I decided I didn't really want to do that anymore, so I wandered around the town a little bit. I came across a Catholic church, and the thing that struck me about the Catholic church is that there were these front steps sort of fanning out in front of the church, and on the front steps they were sacrificing chickens, which is an awful sound. But what piqued my attention was like, this is a little bit weird, right? Here they are just outside of this church that's supposed to be worshiping Jesus, and they're sacrificing chickens to their chicken god. So there was a guy there who had similar skin color to me, and I asked him if he spoke English. He said yes, from the States. And I said, "Do you know what's going on here?" And he said, "Yeah, actually, if you go inside the church, you'll see bulls' heads and things coming out of the wall. So what they've basically done is they've taken animistic religion, you know, the religion of the people there, and they've married it to this Roman Catholic version of Christianity." And mushed it all together, and what you got in the end is they sacrificed the chickens in Jesus' name. You call that syncretism. That's a theological word that we use to describe that kind of thing. Syncretism. It's the idea of taking one religious tradition and shoving it together with another one so that you end up with something that kind of looks like both of them, but not completely. And it's been the approach that the world has had toward religion throughout all of history. And we do it in our culture today. I mean, you can go to other places, you'll find out that they do it as well. We do it when we say stuff like, you know what? I believe that my words have creative power, that I'm going to speak things out into the atmosphere, and then God is going to bring things back to me. There's a book that's been really famous over the years called The Secret. It is not a Christian book. It is sort of New Agey book. So I'm going to speak these things out, and then I'm going to have it come back. But Christian people have picked this up and said, yeah, yes, that's called the law of attraction. And it's a Christian thing. So give me the BMW. And then you get it back. But I say, give me the BMW in Jesus' name, right? So I've married Christianity with this American consumerist mentality, with some kind of new age power of my voice, and pfft, there you go. Syncretism. Israel struggled with this a lot. If you go into the Old Testament, this is usually what they're doing wrong. They are called to worship the one true God, but when the one true God doesn't come through in ways that they think he should come through, they immediately go to plan B, and plan B is usually one of the idols of the people of the land. They've picked up a god from the people of the land, and they go and they worship him instead. And so there ends up being a cycle in the Old Testament where the people of Israel will reject the Lord. The Lord then will send a prophet who will start yelling at them, and they will then repent after a long period of time, and then they will reject him again. And then they sends a prophet, and then repent, and then round and round and round we go. It's basically the whole story of the Old Testament. The reason I'm telling you all of this is because this act of sending a prophet is an act of love. See, the worst thing you can do for people is not intervene when they're doing something that's going to hurt them. Indifference is hatred. So when God sends a prophet, he's showing that he loves the people. And so this story, the story of Elijah, is a story of love. It's a hard love. I mean, Elijah's going to say some things that they don't really like. But he's urging them to come back. So we are starting this new series on Elijah. We're subtitled, How Long Will You Waver? We just finished a series on money. So if this is your first time back, congratulations. You picked the right week to avoid the money talk. This is a story about God's intervening grace. And here in it, we're going to learn in this little passage, only eight verses, we're going to learn three things. And by the way, just as an aside, I am really, really proud of my little titles here, so just be ready, okay? We're gonna learn about a jealous God provoked, a jealous for God prophet, and a jealous God's provision. Right? This just hits you right. You're like, oh, we're in church now. All right, a jealous God provoked, a jealous for God's prophet, and a jealous God's provision. So here's the first of those, a jealous God provoked. Look at verse 1 of 1 Kings 17 with me. What you've got here is a character introduction. You ever watched a movie and they, you know, they start by freezing on each character and then a voiceover comes. This is my friend Joe, and Joe's got this background, and Joe loves this, and Joe. If you ever watched Wile E. Coyote and The Roadrunner, you know, they freeze on The Roadrunner and give a little, that's what this is. The writer here is trying to say, let me introduce you to the characters that you're going to have to become well aware of in the next several stories. Now Elijah, there's the first one. He comes out of nowhere. We don't know anything about Elijah up to this point. Now Elijah, the Tishbite of Tishbe in Galilee. That's all in Gilead. That's the only thing we know. Gilead was a mountainous region. We don't know anything else about Elijah. We don't know how tall he was. We don't know anything at all. We do know more about the guy he has come to talk to. Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, and the people said, boo. Here's why they said boo. Ahab is a bad king. He is so bad, in fact, that he won an award for badness. I'll show you. In the verses immediately preceding the ones we're studying, okay, you just go back like eight verses in the Bible, into chapter 16, one of the things you'll find is this. In the 38th year of Asa, king of Judah, Ahab, the son of Omri, began to reign over Israel. And Ahab, the son of Omri, reigned over Israel in Samaria for 22 years. That's a long reign. It's a long time to be in politics, right? Like, that's a Biden length of politics. It's a joke. And Ahab, the son of Omri, can you imagine, you know, here's the first introduction of this guy in the whole Bible. What do we say about Ahab? Well, we say he did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. Like, if you can think of the worst guy in the history of Israel to lead the country, this is him. He gets an award, in fact, for it. He's the worst, the absolute worst. And as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam. See, Jeroboam was the worst before him, but he caught up with Jeroboam by doing the sins of Jeroboam, and then he went beyond him. He took for his wife Jezebel. He took for his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Etbaal. So this guy is her dad, and he is the king of the Sidonians, and the king of the Sidonians is basically named after their god Baal, who we'll learn more about in a second. He took for his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Etbaal, king of the Sidonians, and he went and he served Baal and worshipped him. So this is the reason that people of Israel weren't supposed to intermarry when they come into the land. When the promised land is in the land of Canaan, the first rule was don't intermarry with the people of the land. Because if you intermarry, you know, your wife, she's going to end up saying to you one day, I really miss my old God. Can we just bring him into the house a little while? And then when he gets into the house, he's going to take over the house. You know what it's like, guys. You know, happy wife, happy life. So she's going to come in, she's going to take over the whole house. And that's what happened. So they served Baal and worshipped him. It's not that they didn't still worship Yahweh. Of course they did. They had the temple and they had all the stuff. But they also had Baal. You know, plan B. Syncretism. One, two, together with one. He erected, Ahab did, an altar to Baal in the house of Baal. He built a temple and an altar for him. Which he built in Samaria, and Ahab made an Asherah. Asherah is Baal's girlfriend. You worshipped her by a big tree, a pole that was usually right next to the altar of Baal, because they're, you know, they go together. And he made an Asherah. Listen, in case you didn't get it the first time around, Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. In his days, Hiel of Bethel built Jericho. When Jericho, you remember with Jericho, you walk around seven times, walls fall down, veggie tales, yep, okay, remember all that? So, after that happened, what the Lord said to the people is, nobody should ever rebuild Jericho. Let it forever be a sign to you of wickedness and the power of God to destroy it and stuff. Nobody's allowed to rebuild Jericho at all. The only person who would ever consider rebuilding Jericho is somebody who despises the Lord and his commandments. That's Ahab. He's like, you know what we should do? We should rebuild Jericho because that would be a great testimony to my name. Everybody will think, what a great king and powerful king. He doesn't even listen to Yahweh. So he rebuilt Jericho, and the rule, of course, was when you rebuild Jericho, the people who rebuild it are going to lose their children. That was the promise that God gave. If you rebuild it, you're going to lose kids. He laid its foundation. This guy who Ahab hired at the cost of Abiram, his firstborn, and he set up its gate at the cost of his youngest son, Segub. That's a good name. According to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Joshua, the son of Nun. So, Ahab, Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Galilee said to Ahab, okay, you got boo, all right? Here's what he said. He said, As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there shall be neither dew nor rain these years except by my word. Why does he say dew or rain? Okay, so remember, we've got an introduction. We introduced Elijah, we introduced Ahab. Now I'm introducing Baal. Baal, the god of the storm. The reason Elijah shows up and says this, it's not going to be dew or rain, is basically he's saying, I'm going to put your god to the test, the one that you've been trusting in instead of Yahweh. We're going to see if he's really alive. He was the god of the storm. If you ever see images of Baal in history, he's got a big lightning bolt in his hand, lots of sculptures that way. Here's how Baal worship worked. The belief was that there was a rainy season and a dry season every year. And during the dry season, the belief was that Mot, the god of death, had killed Baal. In the rainy season, which is what you want, because the most important thing in your whole world was crops, right? And kids. You want there to be fertility on the land and on your spouse. And so the rainy season was a sign of that fertility. Mot killed Baal, but then in the rainy season, Baal comes back to life. So when things are really dry and the dry season's going a long time, you have to convince Baal to come back to life. You have to urge him to come back to life. There's certain ways that you can do this. One of the ways that you could do this is you can dance around in ecstasy and hit yourself and slash yourself with swords. Sounds like fun, huh? Look how much I mean it, Baal. Come back to life. You'll see a picture of this in a little bit when they get up to Mount Carmel. The prophets of Baal will yell a lot. You can also offer sacrifices. I mean, you can offer the chickens on the steps of the temple if you want. If it gets really, really dry, though, and it lasts a long time, you might need to up your game when it comes to the sacrifices. And so you gotta pick something a little more valuable to you. Like, I don't know, your kids? In fact, Baal worship was well known as being the act of worship. Child sacrifice was very common. I care so much about this Baal, I'm going to give you my firstborn. But the most common way that people worshipped Baal was actually by using what's called the temple prostitutes. They would go in to visit the temple prostitutes, and what would happen is that Baal supposedly would sit with his girlfriend Asherah, and they would watch what was going on in the temple between you and the prostitute, and they would emulate it, and then the rains would come. So Baal worship was not a really great thing. Are you happy you came to church today? Baal worship, it was not a great religion. It was, when you hear about the worship of Baal, you should be thinking, oh, these are the Nazis. These are people who boil children. And what you have in this passage, and here's our fourth person, what you have in this passage is the Lord, the God of Israel, who He lives. Baal's dead, but God's alive. Lord, the God of Israel, before whom I stand, there's not going to be dew or rain. This is basically the Lord, the God of Israel, saying, all right, game on. I want to fight Baal. Where is he? It's Elijah announcing that he's sick and tired. God is sick and tired of these people running off to this stupid Baal, and he wants to fight him to prove that he alone, Yahweh alone, is the one who can care for his people. Seen as a divine intervention. When Israel runs to other gods, the true God is jealous for his people. I use that language purposely, okay? This whole story is about how the jealous God comes and intervenes on behalf of the people he's jealous for. That language of jealousy is weird for us when we think about it in relation to God, and yet it's right, it's in the Bible. He's called that. Here's the passage. When they first come into the promised land, these are the rules. When you're there, take care lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land to which you go, lest it become a snare in your midst, right? Jezebel's a snare in their midst. You shall tear down, not build them up, tear down their altars and break their pillars and cut down their asherim, plural for Asherah. Cut them down, for you shall worship no other god
for the Lord, whose name is what? Jealous. Is a jealous God. Wait a minute, isn't that a sin? Isn't jealousy a sin? Well, here's the thing. Jealousy is a sin for you, but not for God. Here's how. Let's imagine that you have a girlfriend or boyfriend, and you guys get together all the time. It's a Friday night, and you say, what are we going to do tonight? And he says, hey, I'm really tired. I'm just going to stay here and play this video game like I do every hour of every other day. So she's like, oh, okay, have fun. Have a good evening. So she calls her friends and says, hey, do you guys want to go out? My boyfriend's not with me tonight, so you guys want to go out? And they're like, oh, we'd love to go out. And so they go to Chili's, because of course, why wouldn't you go to Chili's? So they're there in Chili's, eating their food, baby back ribs, and in comes her boyfriend. But he's not alone. He's with another girl. And at first she thinks to herself, well, I don't know, I've never met his sister, maybe his sister. And then he leans over and kisses her, but it's not a sister kiss. And she's like, oh my word. So she gets up and she walks over to the table and says to him, what do you think you're doing? Now she's jealous. For whom? Well, for herself. He's jealous because she's losing something. I want you in my life. I need you in my life. You do something for me. How could you possibly, she might even say, how could you possibly do this to me? Don't you know what you're doing to me? That's the way jealousy works in our lives. But listen, when God goes to that table and they're sitting down with Baal, God comes and says, how could you possibly do this to you? He doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. But you and I need him. So when he is a jealous God, he comes and he intervenes, not for his sake, but for our sake. I'm not going to sit by and watch you run off to this thing that's going to hurt you. What are you kidding? I love you too much. I'm all that and he's not. When you say that, you're a prideful jerk. When God says that, it's the truth. So he intervenes. He's a jealous God. God knows his people are running away to something earthful, and so he intervenes because he loves. And we get passages of scripture that really kind of emphasize this, but we don't even recognize it when we run across them. So one of my favorite passages in the whole Bible is Psalm 23, right? The Lord is my shepherd, shall not want, makes me lie down in green pastures. Right in the middle of that psalm is this phrase, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. But in what sense is Jesus, the good shepherd, with us? What about his presence helps us feel comforted? Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Those are two different things. See, a shepherd would carry a rod because when the wolves come along, you got to have something to beat them down with, right? I mean, you got a big stick, and they come, and you, and the other one comes, and the rod is not for the sheep, though. For the sheep, he has a staff. You know, shepherd's crook. He has a staff. Now, the staff is really useful because when the sheep who are dumb, I lived in New Zealand for several years, and let me tell you, I learned a lot about sheep there. They are really, really dumb. They will wander off and die in a day if you don't watch them. So the shepherd, when they're wandering off into a place that's dangerous or they're right on the edge of a cliff or something, the shepherd will come and he will bring them back. He will steer them back. In New Zealand, actually, they have this little phrase called rattle your dags. Rattle your dag. Rattle your dags. It means hurry up. Here's what it means. Dags are what happens at the back end of the sheep when the sheep has to go to the bathroom repeatedly and then it all gets caught in there. Like I said, it's a great day at church. Right? So That's what happens. And so they call those dags. And so when the sheep runs, the dags rattle, right? So you say, hey, rattle your dags. It means hurry up. I just want you to think about this. But what a shepherd will do with the dags, because they get really big. A shepherd will come along, he'll take his staff, and he'll whoop the back end of the sheep. Then the sheep's thinking, what are you doing? I'm minding my own business out here. I'm not getting lost or anything, and you just whack me in the rear end? What kind of hateful act is that? And the shepherd's like, yeah, you don't know what's behind you here, buddy. Right? We got to get rid of a lot of this. You wonder why your life is hard sometimes. Yeah, God's back there. There's a lot of stuff in here, right? He's sometimes you go off away, and he's like pulling you back. And when you do this, that happens to a sheep. The sheep's like, oh, come on, there's good grass down there. And the shepherd's like, if you go down there, you're going to die from the wolves. You do see that most of the things that are happening in your life, the things that you despise, the things that frustrate you, are acts of a gracious God, your great shepherd, who is steering you in right paths. You and I yell and scream and hold our fists. What are you doing? Ever wonder why you don't get what you want? God's jealous for you. His intervention is not a sign of his distaste or anger toward you. His intervention is a sign of love. Right, second one. A jealous for God prophet. I want to go to the first verse again. Now, I want to show you something that's not here. Now, Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there shall be neither dew nor rain in these years except by my word. Here's what's not here. The Lord, the God of Israel, came to Elijah and said, go to Ahab and declare yada, yada, yada. The reason I say that is because that should be right in front of this. When God comes to Jonah, and he says, go to Nineveh, the first verse of Jonah is, word of the Lord came to Jonah and said, go to Nineveh and tell them off. You do not have this here. In fact, several places when a prophet is called, the prophet is called by God. God shows up to Nathan before he goes to David. God shows up all the time before the people go. He shows up in a burning bush before he sends Moses. Where is God showing up to Elijah? Now look, that could be the writers like, and I can't be bothered to say that anyway. It's just, you know, too many words. It might be, just assume it. Just assume that that was a scene that actually happened and that Elijah was minding his own business and the Lord came to him. Or it could be that Elijah, the prophet, was sitting there minding his own business and was watching what was happening in his nation and said, not on my watch. God called me to be a prophet to Israel, to Ahab. I'm not going to sit by and watch this nation go sideways. And so he picks up his little satchel and his stick and he walks right into Ahab and he says to him, look, there's not going to be dew or rain till I say so. Look, it doesn't really matter how he got there. The point I'm trying to make is that Elijah was a willing accomplice to God's plans for intervention. He wasn't Jonah. He was excited about doing this thing. He saw what God was doing and he believed that what God was doing in intervention was what needed to happen. God was jealous for his people, and so was Elijah. He knew that false teaching kills. Because that's what this is, right? Isn't that basically that's what it is? I mean, here you got Jezebel and Ahab bringing Baal into the worship of Yahweh and they're mushing it together and basically false teaching. They're saying, look, your worship to Yahweh alone is not worth it. It's not going to work, especially when you need rain to come. You need to worship this Baal as well. So you got plan A and plan B or plan 1A, whatever. It's false teaching. What are you supposed to do when somebody who's a friend or a brother or sister in the faith flirts with false teaching? What are you supposed to do? Just sit back and watch it happen?
Well, there's lots of different ways to view these things, so I guess I'll just watch you go down that hill and die.
Should we be commended for our indifference or our sit back on our hands while we watch people walk away? Should pastors be commended for not saying anything about false teaching and just, let's just stay positive? One of my favorite passages, whenever I get together with pastors, and I've done some pastors' conferences, one of my favorite passages of scripture to teach on is actually out of the book of Exodus, chapter 32. It's when Moses goes up on the mountain and he's going to receive the law from God. Remember, the mountain is covered with a cloud. He goes up there, and he's gone a long time. Down in the valley, you've got Aaron, like associate pastor, right? Executive pastor. He's down there in the valley. And the people are looking up the mountain every day, and Moses never coming back. And, of course, if you live in those days and some guy climbs a mountain and doesn't come back, you're like, he probably fell. Or he's up there with God, and he's like, I prefer God to those guys. So he's just staying up there. Whatever, they're gone. They're on a trip. We're left all alone without a God to protect us in the middle of this wilderness. We need a God. And so they come to Aaron and they ask him for one. Yahweh on the top of the mountain, who's talking to Moses, says, hey, do you know what those guys are doing down the valley? I need you to go back down there, Moses, and see, because I'm kind of angry because they've turned and made this golden calf that they're now marching around and dancing around and calling it their God. So here's where we pick it up. Verse 19, Exodus 32, and as soon as he came, Moses came to the camp and saw the calf and the dancing, Moses' anger burned hot, like Elijah hot. And he threw the tablets, the Ten Commandments, out of his hands. He broke them at the foot of the mountain. He took the calf that they had made and burned it with fire and ground it to powder and scattered it on the water and made the people of Israel drink it. Drink it! You want it? Drink it! Love this guy. And then Moses said to Aaron, pastor says to executive pastor, stupid executive pastor. What did this people do to you that you've brought such a great sin upon them? What, did they tie you up? Did they tell you that they weren't going to provide, you know, your pay or something? What? They kick you out of the parsonage? What'd they do? And Aaron said, okay now, I can see you're angry. Let not the anger of my Lord burn hot. We just need to just calm down for a minute, breathe. Moses, you know these guys. You know the people that they're set on evil. You know Joe, right? Sally! Always set on evil, right? For they said to me, make us gods who shall go before us. Remember the pillar of cloud and the fire, and that was gone. They don't have anything. So they came to me and they said, make us some gods. I didn't know what to do. As for this Moses, they said, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, well, we don't know what's become of him. Our leader is gone. So then I said to them in response, let any who have gold take it off. So they gave it to me, and I picked it all up, and I just threw it in the fire. I just threw it in the fire, and out came this calf. Blam, there it is. Not my fault. Stupid executive. This is a great act of pastoral malpractice. So is Aaron to be commended for doing what the people wanted by providing them with another God? Well, of course not. And you and I are not to be commended for sitting by and watching and accommodating other people's desires for false teaching. We're not. It's not a good thing that we just sit by and watch and make excuses for people who want to add things to the pure, unadulterated gospel of Jesus and then form a brand new religion, but use all the same words. And in 6 months, 9 months, whatever, they just fall off the map. Or they call what they believe Christianity, and you and I know it's not. It is not the good deposit we were supposed to guard. There's a song that was written a number of years ago. It's actually a rap by Shy Lin. I don't know if you know him. He's a great rapper, so I'm going to rap it for you now. Not really, but kind of, okay? The song is about false teachers, and here's some lines from it. He says, and I ain't really trying to start beef, but some who claim to be part of the sheep got some sharp teeth. And cats get mean when you criticize them, but Jesus told us, Matthew 7:16, we can recognize them. And God forbid that for the love of some fans, I keep quiet and watch them die with their blood on my hands, so there's nothing left for me to do except to speak to you in the spirit of Jude 3 and 2 Peter 2. And I know some will label me a Pharisee, because today the only heresy is saying that there's heresy. I'll dare to be specific and drop some clarity on the popularity of the gospel of prosperity. Dude, and then he goes into names. He's just naming names. When this song came out, there was all sorts of, you know, hubbub online about, how dare you say this? How do you know false teaching? You call false teaching, that's just your view and stuff. Shy Lin had done his homework, and he presented a whole bunch of material saying, this is wrong. This is false. And so he names names. People think he's crazy, nuts, wicked, awful. I think he's just avoiding the sin of Aaron. He could have had thousands of reasons for not publishing a song or not speaking out, and yet there he is, Elijah, saying, not on my watch. Man, you should seek. I don't know what your future is going to hold in regards to church. I don't know what your future is going to hold in regards to listening to podcasts or anything like that, but can I just give you a massive piece of advice? Choose wisely who you hear. Consider what you're listening to. There's no honor in passively watching people run after idols. Elijah's approach is right. He was a jealous for God prophet. All right, last one. A jealous God's provision. All right, so I only went through one verse. That took a while on one verse. Here's the rest of it. And the word of the Lord came to him. So because Elijah's gone to Ahab, and he's told him off. No dew, no rain, till I say so. And then the word of the Lord comes to him. See, it's weird. Should have come before. Word of the Lord came to him, and he, depart from here. Turn eastward and hide by the brook of Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. Well, why do you got to hide? Isn't God with him? Yeah, but listen, Ahab and Jezebel, they are not the kind of people who, when you come and you confront them, they're like, that is a really good point. Let's bring HR in, and we can talk this through, and you can give your good points to me, and we can dialogue about it so that we can be better, man. Nope. They're like, you're dead. How dare you come in here and lecture us? You're dead. So God's like, get out. Get out of there right away. Turn eastward. Hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. You're going to drink from the brook. And I've commanded the ravens to feed you there. Ravens, crows, scavenger birds. You know, because they're really well known for feeding you and not you feeding them, right? My son, Ethan, we were in Australia, and he was sitting there with his ham sandwich. I still remember sitting in his little stroller with his ham sandwich because he was really tired of the day. We had gone to some park, and he was sitting there. And in Australia, they have these scavenger birds. Their ravens are these weird-looking birds with these long beaks, and they just sort of wander around. And he was sitting there, and this bird walks up to him, looks at him, takes its beak and grabs the sandwich and starts eating it right in his face. And he's looking at his hand, and he's like, "Wah!" He starts freaking out, because that's what scavenger birds do. They take and eat your food. There's nobody in the world who's sitting down and saying, you know what we should do with Grubhub? We should just get a bunch of crows. We just strap that food to them and I'll take them right there. No, because they'll eat it. And yet God's like, no, I can control the ravens. They're going to be my delivery animals just to prove to you that I've got power over everything. I'm going to use the ravens to feed you there. And so he went, he did according to the word of the Lord. He went and he lived by the brook Cherith to the east of the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat. They don't eat meat often there. I mean, it's very rare for them to eat meat all the time, but he gets two meals a day with meat. Bread and meat in the evening. He drank from the brook, and after a while, the brook dried up because there was no rain. There's no rain in the land. Look, I find this remarkable. Elijah knew. He knew it was risky and dangerous to confront Ahab, but he still did it. He didn't let his fear of a possible future stop him from being faithful. You know what I mean? The fear of the possible future, like in his mind, he's not an idiot. Somewhere along the way, when he's on his way to confront Ahab, isn't he thinking to himself, okay, when I confront this guy, he's probably going to get angry and I'm going to ruin my life. I could just sit back and do nothing, right? That's the safe approach. But he goes through with it anyway. See, one reason many of us don't make faithful decisions honoring God is because we're afraid of where that faithfulness will lead us. We play fortune teller and let our limited view of the future scare us out of obedience. But listen, our view of the future usually doesn't include the ravens. You know what I'm talking about here? Like, okay, we just went through a series on money. You get to the end of a series like that, and we've urged you, I've urged myself over and over again to say, look, you cannot give God, you cannot give God, you cannot give God. And so now you're in a position and you're thinking to yourself, how do I want to respond to that? And in your mind, you're thinking, well, I want to respond in a gospel-sized response. And so your heart is drawn toward what you've read. And yet, while you're sitting there with the money in your hand, ready to give it to the poor or the needy or the missionary or the church, the money in your hand, you're thinking to yourself, okay, but what if I give this and God doesn't come through? What if my kid needs certain fees paid? What if the economy keeps going the way it goes? What if it's really bad and we pay $9 gas? What if it gets worse and worse and worse and I need this money in 2 years in order to do something? I'm totally regret this. So what you've done is you've created a possible future, but it's an atheistic one, isn't it? The same God who has led you all along the way is now not included in the future plans that you've got. This is what happens when you and I are sitting there and we have an opportunity to tell the truth, and we know that the truth-telling is going to lead us into some hot water. We try to do it gently and graciously, but we know that by telling the truth and saying this thing, it's going to lead to a whole bunch of trouble. And we start thinking out the future, right? If I do this, I might lose my job. And if I do this, I'm going to be hated here, and I'm going to be treated this way there. I'm not going to be able to find anything if they do this, if they do this. What if, what if, what if, what if, what if, what if? And so we shrink back from doing the honest, right, obedient thing because of an atheistic future that we created in our heads. But God's got ravens. He's got ravens. Don't forget the ravens. He can take the stupidest scavenging bird, flip it around, and turn it into Grubhub. Look, I'll finish with this. One of my favorite passages, actually, in the Bible, I have a lot of favorite ones here in the Old Testament, is out of Numbers chapter 13. The reason it's my favorite is because how this whole thing ties together. So follow this story here. People of Israel have come across the Red Sea. They've been led by a pillar, fire, you know, and God has led them across the land. He's provided them manna when they needed it. He's provided them everything they need in order to trust him and believe that he's going to take them into safety into the promised land. They get to the edge of the promised land, and they do the smartish thing, right? The thing that we would do. Let's send in some spies. They send them in. The spies come out. Here's what they say. At the end of 40 days, the spies returned from spying out the land, and they came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the people of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh, and they brought back word to them and to all the congregation. And they showed them, look, the fruit of the land. Look at this. Look what we found. It's enormous. And they told him, Moses, we came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. However, the people who dwell in the land are obviously strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there, those vicious Amalekites. They dwell in the land of the Negev, the Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites. They dwell in the hill country. The Canaanites dwell by the sea. They're everywhere. And along the Jordan, but Caleb, oh, we love him. Caleb, hold on, everybody. Just settle down. He quieted the people before Moses and said, let's do it. Come on, baby. Let's go. Let us go up at once and occupy it. We don't need to wait. Stop talking. Start walking. We are well able to overcome it. We got God on our side. What say you? Well, the man who had gone up with him said, look, we're not able to go up against the people. They're obviously stronger than we are. So they brought to the people of Israel a bad report of the land, and they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone to spy it out is a land that devours, guys, it devours its inhabitants. There's just no way. It's going to eat us alive. And all the people we saw in it, they're huge. They're super tall. And we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, who come from the Nephilim. They're just 8-9 feet. They're huge. And we seemed to ourselves like grasshoppers. And so we seemed to them. We can't do it. So what have they done? Okay, God, the God of Israel, has led them. They were the people who stood at the edge of the Red Sea and saw it split, yeah? And then they walked through on dry land. This God delivered them in the most amazing ways. They get to the edge of the promised land. They're like, we can't do it. We can't do it. We can't do it. All right, they'll go back in the wilderness for 40 years. They come back to the Jordan River. 40 years later, they will go across. They're going to now attack Jericho. VeggieTales, down. Here we go. Joshua chapter 2. They go and see this woman, Rahab, who hides them because she thinks that they're going to come and win this battle. And they go and stay in her place quietly. Before the men lay down in the evening, she came up to them on the roof, and she said to them, the men, look, I know that the Lord has given you the land. I know it. And that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants, all the strong inhabitants of the land melt away before you. Look. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea 40 years earlier before you when you came out of Egypt and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted. And there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heavens above and on the earth beneath. The Lord went before them, and yet they backed out because they believed he didn't exist now. God is on the other side of the decisions that you're making, and he's saying, just be faithful in the decision. I'm not asking you to sort out the future. I'll sort out the future. Make this decision right now. Throw yourself into the hands of the living God who controls the ravens. And trust that he will bring what you need when you need it. Look, where is God calling you to be faithful today? Don't fear. Don't what if yourself to death. You don't know the future, but we do know the God of the ravens. He's gone before us. You can never risk too much for Jesus. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your grace and a passage like this that reminds us again that you are faithful and powerful. Father, we read this stuff all in Scripture over and over again, and we're challenged by the fact that we don't trust you. We think that all the ways that you've led us up to this point, you're now going to abandon us in this particular moment. But I pray, Lord, I pray that the people of Harvest Bible Chapel will be known for doing the next right thing and leaving the future in the hands of the God who controls the future, who's got ravens at the ready, who's gone before us and is working for our good and his glory. So make us faithful. Spirit, come. Spirit, come and make us faithful. Give us courage and boldness to do what's set before us with everything we've got and leave the consequences to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's sing. And our Father in heaven, the light of salvation.
Surgery on my heart right back there. So let's be in prayer this weekend that this preaching wouldn't just stay in this church, but that it would just bear fruit. And like I said earlier today, we would love to care for you. So if you have any questions, any prayer that you need, any way that you need to get connected, we're going to have some leaders up front here and some of our staff, and then we'll be in the connect room and in the lobby as well. But just know this, know that you are loved. The way to Samado.